And I started my development career at Procurious. Before that, I was a social worker. I worked with young people. I got stuck with all the bureaucratic stuff that was going on, and I needed to change, and Procurious gave me the opportunity to start programming with them. So that's what I do. In the beginning, I went to conferences, and there was always talk about microservices, and everybody was like, yeah, you need to do them, and they're great, and they solve all your problems. So I went back to our lead developers, and I was like, why are we doing microservices? We need to do them because they solve all our problems. And they looked at me like, you're just coming around. No, we don't do them because we don't see any benefit in them for our big monolithic application. So a little bit about our big monolithic application, just for context. We started developing our application 15 years ago. Yeah, we have legacy that is 15 years old, and it earns us money right now. We started they started because I wasn't even programming back then. We started developing in PHP 5, beta 3. So at that time, my colleagues decided to start building it in a beta version of PHP, the first PHP version that could object-oriented programming, because they thought back then that was the way to go. Just a little bit of context about how old our application is. We have about, and now we need 3 million lines of PHP code in our application. That's a lot. There's also HTML, CSS, JavaScript, all kinds of stuff. So, yeah. That is, and 18,000 PHP files. All in one code base. We work on this code base with 20 developers every day in the same code base. And it goes well. So we don't need microservices for that at all. We deploy multiple times a day. We just hit a button and the new version is online. And yeah, front end, like 350 lines of JavaScript and all that. And it's all in one application. Usage, because now you think, well, that's not going to perform well if it's all in one application. We have 8 web servers running all the time. We have, out of the top of my head, 2,000 clients who work with our product on a daily basis. They have 8,000 users that are going logging in into the backend. And we have 500,000, yeah, 500,000 visitors, and I guess at what rate?
An hour,
indeed, an hour. So our big monolithic application with all those lines of PHP code, every request, it gets built up, it handles the request, it gets turned down, it's 500,000 times an hour. And as long as none of our clients is doing a commercial during a football match, it all goes well. Half a year ago, we had one client did it, and the server went, well, collapsed. But we fixed it. We noticed, like with profiling, that some of our images weren't cached good enough. And we solved the problem, and now we can even do that. Yeah, so here you have a 2,000 client, or 800,000 users over the clients, and 500,000 visitors an hour. And it's not a big pile of mud. Yeah, some parts are. Some parts we have put a fence around and say to every programmer, do not go there. We have some parts of the system that's like, ah, it's mod event, oh no. No, we don't want to go there. No, Taco, can you do it? Because he knows mod event. So yeah, it's not all shiny, but it's good enough. And I was like, why aren't we doing microservices? And I started looking for a definition of a microservice. And this is just an assumption. This is not a real definition because I couldn't find one. But I think this one is great. Microservices or microservice architecture is an approach to application development in which a large application is built as a suite of modular components or services. And I thought to myself, which large application is built of a suite of modular components or services? And I thought, dude, we have that. It's exactly what we do, but we call them modules. We have those bounded contexts within encapsulation. We have small parts of our code base that do just change one thing of our application. We have a finance module that does all the invoicing. We have a payment module that does all the payments. We have a subscription module for all the subscriptions. And they talk to each other. They all talk to each other. They all work together to handle our business logic. But if we change something within our subscription module, there is nothing changed within our invoicing module. And vice versa. We have some rules about these modules. They cannot really interfere with each other's database tables. Yeah, they share one database, but we have a strict rule that you cannot go from one module directly into the database tables of another module. And this is hard for young developers, because they think, I need this, and I'm just going to put this SQL query right here, because I need it here. No, we have rules for that. So what we have is something we call an API. And it's really, we build it up like with a factory. We don't have service container or DI container, because back when we started, those things weren't really good enough for our application. And we decided to go with a static service factory. And we call it an API factory. And this one is particularly for our meeting module. And as you can see, it's called module name, API factory. And every module has this. So if I'm a developer and I need something from my invoicing module from the meeting, or in the next example, a user, I just ask it on the factory. So I'm just going to do user factory, user API factory, get user API, get current user. The whole abstraction is that I don't know where the user is coming from. It can come from a microservice, it can come from an external service, I don't know. So let's take a look at the last one here, the registration API. It's a real simple example, but it looks a bit like that. It has one method, register, and it can register an attendee. It just goes to the repository and it creates it, and the repository create one, saves it, and returns the just created registration. Is this clear? So, let's take a look from a controller. As you can see here at the top, I just do user API factory, get user API, get current user. So I have the user, I check if it's authenticated, and if not, I return to the login page, because in our application, if you want to register for a meeting, you have to be logged in, we have to know who you are. Then we do some form handling, like which slots do you want to attend, stuff like that. And we just call the meeting API factory get registration API register. Easy, right? There's no HTTP request. There's nothing going on. It's all in one request. If everything gets broken down, I know exactly where to look, because we have monitoring. And I get a nice ticket. And I don't have to look in which service has gone, all that stuff we don't have. And eventually, I redirect back to the homepage. But you can do whatever you want. So we have a modular monolith, really. But for us, the best thing is that I can debug everything. If I get a ticket with there is a bug in this and I need to solve out what's going wrong, I can easily put a breakpoint anywhere in code, run the request, and just check if I'm going to end up there. If not, okay, I'm going to put another breakpoint somewhere else and check if I'm going to end up there. It's really easy for us to debug our application. It's real easy for young developers to explore our application, because we just tell them, well, you have the module name, you have the API factory, and you get a list of everything that you can do. You get a list of every API the module serves. And the moment you choose one, because of PHP Storm, you get a list of every service it has. So a new developer can rapidly go get his way around with our application. They don't need to know where the service lives or how it's going to be called to. We just tell them, well, you have this easy thing. But what is a modular monolith? It is down to two things. It is bounded context with no dependencies on each other. And information can be duplicated over those bounded contexts. But if we look at our example, there are some things not really going right. And that is that I still, if I want to have something from another, like the user, or some other information, I have to get it out of another module. And maybe that's not what I want. Maybe I want for my registration, not that every module gets its information from my database. No, maybe they have to find another way for it. So what you want to do with this, what you can do if you have a legacy application and you want to start doing something about encapsulation of your bounded context, is start to send messages from your modules. Let the world know, let the other parts of the application know what happened. It's not event sourcing. It can be done with event sourcing, but it doesn't have to be. So let's take a look at an example. This was our register method from a while ago, and now we're going to add our message to the world that what's happened. And it looks like this. I just cut out the registration. As you can see, it still creates one from the repository. I put it in a registration created event, and I just go get the listeners for that event. The beautiful part of this piece of code is that my meeting module has no idea what other modules there are that want to know that a registration was created. It can be one, it can be 10, and it can be zero. And it doesn't care. The other thing is that the other modules who register to listen for this event doesn't need to know if the module is even there. It might not be. So you don't have to get a check that if this module is installed, then do this, another way, do that. No, you can just listen to the events that happened. And you can do this for register, unregister, cancel, all kinds of stuff. And like I said, it could be within projection. If you do, is there anyone here who has experience with event sourcing a little bit? You know projections, what they are? Not everybody. When you do event sourcing, real quick, you just put a command on your application. The command gets handled, and the handler returns an event of what was happened with data in it. And you have your command side of the application that has an event store behind it, where all that has happened is stored. So reading from that event store is quite expensive to know the actual state of your application if you want to show it to the user. And you create projections or read models to store the current state of your application. But you can't trust your read models. You have to trust your event store. You have to trust everything that happened before to validate if the new command is valid. And you just use your projection for your reading. And it is an event listener. It listens to events. So in this case, the registration created event really is a domain event, like an event sourced event. And I just have a registration projection within the same module, but I could have a projection outside my module that listens to that event to duplicate the data within. So if I need to show something about my payments for my registration, I could create a separate module for that just to show which registrations were there, and I could couple my payment data to the same in the same record to show it to the user. Is that a bit clear? Any questions about this? So what to do with your legacy monolith if you have one? Most people tend to start immediately to go to the microservice. They start to do everything the right way. They tend to do it over an HTTP request, extract everything. Hopefully they build a little circle around it where they can route stuff maybe to the old application and maybe to the new application, which is also a great way. But I want to suggest another approach and just start building your bounded context within your monolith. Just look at your monolith and say, well, this kind of holds together. I'm going to separate this in a new directory. I'm going to build my public API around it, and it just passes through to the code that's already there. You don't have to rewrite all the code that's there. You just leave it as it is, as it is, and you just put a wrapper around it. The basic basic example for that, if you have somewhere a query that writes a new entity into the database, just put a wrapper around it, a method, and put it in what the API you saw. So you could easily not have to build a repository. You have to, maybe you have to SQL query directly in your controller, get it out, put it into an API, and every call that goes through there is now in the API. And you could easily refactor that. You just need to keep the public API method intact, and you could easily refactor all the logic behind it. And at one certain moment, you realize, well, this part of the application really needs to go to its own service, because PHP is not the right language, because we have issues with deployment. And then you can extract easily the whole thing around out of it, but you still keep the API intact. So the other application just talks to the API, and the API says, well, I'm going to put it over there. So some takeaways. It's really a fast presentation, I'm sorry. Locate and isolate bounded contexts and turn them into modules. It's a first step. And let the world know what changed in an event-driven plugin architecture. I believe these things are easily to do within even a monolithic application. You could, the moment you start building something new, you could easily implement this right away. I hope you enjoyed my really fast talk. So that's it. Thank you. And of course, are there any questions? None? I don't believe it. Was it that bad? not that bad, a bit bad. Well, that's okay if there are no questions. If you have any, oh yeah. Our company?
They didn't start using a framework in the beginning?
We built our own framework.
Yeah, sorry.
I forgot to mention that. Yeah, we have our own framework. We have some part of Symfony in it. We use Twig, for example. There are some other parts, but mostly it's our own framework. We have built everything from scratch, because when they started, there aren't any good PHP frameworks that could handle the load we were looking for. Yeah.
There's no plan like to refactor stuff like and go to like a Symfony 4 or something?
No, at the moment not, because, well, it would take us a lot of time to do, probably a couple of years. And if we do that, we go bankrupt within 2 months. So, like I said, we have the legacy, and of course, if we start all over, should start all over again, yeah, we immediately Symfony or Laravel or any other we don't want to build it all again. But at the moment, it earns us money, and we don't have any. It's not any trouble to us that it's our own framework. When we have new developers, and especially if we have developers who come from a Symfony or Laravel environment, they have a bit of. They have some time to get adjusted to our way of work, because we don't have a service container. We do it in a different way. But eventually, it's a real easy learning curve that we have because of the static API calls that you can just call, and it's really discoverable. Yeah. In production 7.2, and I think our development environment is 7.3. Yeah.
So when you're first starting 5.0, beta 3, whatever, at some point you have to go to the new version of PHP.
Yeah.
Structures get deprecated, so structures get completely obsolete. In such a huge code base, how do you handle stuff like that? Because it appears to me that it's going to be a huge project just to make it compatible with a new minor major version of PHP, all of testing.
Yeah. To be honest, we don't use a lot of PHP functions. If we do, it's really in the framework part of the application and not so at the business logic. We just use a lot of objects and a lot of classes and interfaces, and that's all there. But sometimes we have to. Well, I think our migration from PHP 5.6 to PHP 7, well, we skipped PHP 7.0, because by the time we were done with the migration, PHP 7.1 was already there. So that was an issue, because some of our libraries weren't compatible anymore with PHP 7. So we had to get another library for some parts of the system, and, well, create a whole new infrastructure around it. So yeah, that sometimes is a problem, but it's nothing compared with starting to redo it all in microservices.
You make a good case for sticking with monoliths, but I would like to know, what do you think are, or what do you experience are some of the challenges that you currently have because
we have some. Well, like I said, we can scale up easily. We have 8 web servers. That's it. And of course, we have a load balancer and a lot of caching and a lot of stuff before. But eventually, there are 8 web servers, and we can't easily say, "Oh, it's high traffic. Just through more services up in the air." If it's done, it's done. So that's one thing.
Do you know why?
Because our servers have a Git checkout of the complete application. So if you want to create a new web server, you have to do a checkout, run some stuff on it. It would take. Not for this, no, because not to rebuild an entire server, because it's not happened very.
Can you version of your code?
That goes automatically, almost. Yeah, we have every module has its own setup, and there we go. We put the table statements in, and when you adjust the table, it goes in there, and every minute, there is a job running that does the setup, and it checks if the file has changed, and if so, it does, it runs, and every 1,000 times it runs. So the migration is within the module, and that's really nice. So deployment, I think PHP saved our ass, because PHP has only runtime and no compile time. That's easy, because we just hit a button, and all the web servers are fetching the new version of the code. I could easily do it right now. I only need an internet connection, so yeah.
It's going to be hard to find it.
Does it answer your questions?
Yeah.
Yeah, so scaling.
Yeah. And sometimes, but I'm not sure if that's really a bad thing. Sometimes we have a lot of merge conflicts, but it's not that common. But sometimes we do a lot of changing in some what we call core modules. We have our CMS, our relation management system, that are modules that almost every other module interrupts with connects with that one. So changes over there may resolve a merge conflicts, which is nasty. And if you have separated services over separated teams, you don't have to deal with that. But we talk to each other face to face. That's one thing that I think is great at our company. We don't have separated teams that are on little islands. The moment I have a problem with someone, I just get up, walk to him or her, and ask, you have done this and I've done that, and now I've got a conflict, can you help me out? And that's really nice. And I think that's one of the, you need to have that. You need to talk to your colleagues about what you're doing if you're working on an application this large with that many developers. But the one thing I like the most about a monolithic application is Shift F6 from PHP Storm. The moment I want to change something, I just put Shift F6 and the whole code base, it is changed. So I don't have to look where the method is called, and it's just, I can change everything. But then you get merge conflicts.
Okay, and you said it's making good money?
Yep.
What does it do?
Everything, a little bit. We do that. We have a web to print module. Yeah. No. What we do? We have CRM. So customer relationship management is our core business, but we have all services around that a little bit. So we have mailings. We do. We have some kind of marketing email. Probably not as fancy as FlexMail over here, but we have it. So our clients come to us, and most of the time it's like, okay, what do you use now for a CRM? We have an Excel sheet. That's on my laptop. And then there is an Excel sheet that's for mailing. And then there is an Excel sheet that's on her laptop, and that's for invoicing. And there is an Excel sheet on his laptop, and that's for subscriptions. All right, and how do we talk to each other? We mail them to each other. Great, and we need to type everything. And sometimes things get lost. We understand. So what we sell is to put everything together. We have a subscription module where you can add someone, give a subscription to someone, a person in the CRM, they are a member. The subscription has a certain payment that has to be due. You generate invoices. Those invoices you send by email to your client. The client pays it, and it comes back to the system, and the financial man knows exactly what happened. And that's what we do. And the moment you have a new subscription, you can email everyone from our system, and everything is in one place. So you don't have to export your email addresses to MailChimp or FlexMail or whatever. You don't have to maintain any coupling with other applications. But it's not that good. It's not a fancy marketing tool that we have. We know when someone opened an email, we know when someone clicked on a link, but that's it. It's a great company to work. Any more questions?
And how long was, because it was built 15 years ago, did they already had like modules back then? Or was it something that's like recently, like in the last years?
We had modules back then. We had folders and we had code in there. But some of our modules still have, and maybe some people know this, like we call them a managed.php file. It's not even a class, it's really a file. And it starts on top with switch URI data. Yeah, so we break up the URI in an array, and we just say, well, switch URI data 0. And if it's this, then do this, and if it's this, then do this, and it's a file like this. We still have that, and it still earns us money. So we have modules, but we are still evolving in how do we want to let them communicate with each other and work. So yeah, we split up our code from the very beginning. Yeah.
You are saying that the code is earning money.
Yeah.
But the code cannot earn more money. You cannot scale. You cannot add more servers. Is that not a problem?
Well, we can add more clients on the same code. So at this moment, it's not a problem. No, we just don't. No, not at the moment. Maybe in the future. But then it's time to build another web server, and it's fine to do that. So, but at the moment, it's not a problem. We even have one client that has over 1 million relations in our CRM. And the application got a bit slow, so we did some improvements on how to catch code, caching, and all kinds of stuff, and it's workable. So when we hit a problem, yeah, we solve it. But then there's the need to solve it. We're not going to solve it in advance. It really needs to hit us in the face, like, yeah, now it's important enough to start to think about something. And of course, we know where our problems might be, because we profile and we check everything. But we're not going to fix it in advance. Only if it's costing us money or potential.
All right.
Any more questions? If not, I registered the meetup, so you can ask me anything by meetup.com or Twitter or whatever. And I will be walking around a little bit after this. Right. So thank you very much
you.
For this tryout.